Welcome to the Worth Listening Podcast, where we focus on having positive and productive conversations about money. Join your host, Lauren Williams, four-time Olympian turned financial planner, as her guests share their stories about how they manage money. We aim to help you own your personal money story and feel good talking about it. Lauren will teach you that money is a tool that can help you live the life you want. You should feel comfortable listening, sharing, and communicating about it. And now, here's your host, Lauren Williams.
Hello, and welcome to the Worth Listening Podcast. I'm your host, Lauren, and today I'm excited to have DJ Moultrie here to share his money memoir. DJ successfully launched his private equity firm, KOG Acquisitions, in 2012. Since then, he's worked with investors to secure over 11 digital companies and is currently raising capital for independent feature films. DJ was able to find an area to specialize in college that allowed him to become an expert in an industry that most people know very little about. He shares a lot of valuable nuggets with us today, so let's listen as DJ shares his money memoir with us. All right, everybody, welcome to the Worth Listening Podcast. Today, I am excited to have DJ Moultrie as our guest. DJ, thanks for being on the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
All right, so why don't we just start at the beginning, give people a little bit of a flavor for who you are, where you're from, and telling us a little bit about you. Also, tell us your first memory of money.
Sure. My name is DJ Moultrie. I am headquartered now in Charlotte, North Carolina. But I grew up as an Army brat. I was born in Denver, Colorado. I lived in Hawaii. I lived in Texas for a little bit. I also lived in Clearwater, Florida, right outside of St. Petersburg, Florida. And also in Columbia, South Carolina. And now I live in Charlotte, North Carolina. My first experience with money was really my first job. I started working when I was 14 years old. And I think back then, man, was I getting paid like $5.50 an hour or like $6 an hour? It was something crazy. But my first experience was getting those checks and not knowing what to do with them, but just keep working hard on getting those checks and realizing that I wasn't really accomplishing the things I wanted to accomplish until a huge light bulb went off in my head years later.
So what was your first job at 14 years old?
Well, technically my first job was Annie Ann's Pretzels in the mall.
Ooh, I love Annie.
Yeah, I used to love making the cinnamon sugar pretzels, the glazing raisin pretzels. So that was my first job. Back then, I literally ran the whole store, depending on who was working that day.
At 14 years old?
I mean, not the first day, but after being there 60 days, 90 days, there was a point where I was running basically the whole store at a time. So I would be able to do the pretzels, run a cash register, count money at night. Now, sometimes we'd have managers come in there that were older that would kind of monitor everything. But for the most part, we basically ran the whole store ourselves.
Okay, so Annie Ann's, and then where'd you go on to, what was the next means of employment?
So I did that for like a year or two. I had to be 16 before I could work at the grocery store, which to me was a big job. Ooh, I get to be a bagger or a cashier at the grocery store. Back then, that's where my mind was at. So then I went to Food Lion at 16. The moment I could apply there, I already had the connects and everything. I said, I want to work here. So then I went to Food Lion. I worked there for my rest of my time going into college.
It's so interesting. It's so interesting that you could work at Annie Ann's at 14 where you had to do stuff with food physically that people were going to eat. You were messing with stoves, cooking things. But the grocery store where there's no actual kitchen, you had to
eat. I know. And the thing is, I still think 16 is too young because I'm selling cigarettes and alcohol at a grocery store. But hey, I just wanted to get the check. And so, but yeah, it is crazy when you start looking at the rules and you actually see the things that you're actually doing, it doesn't match up.
So you started working at 14. You moved to the grocery store. Did you get an upgrade in pay?
I mean, back then it seemed like a lot, but it was probably 25 cents, maybe 50 cents. But back then.
But you still got upgraded.
Yeah, I got an upgrade. But I mean, looking back, it wasn't that big.
And so why were you working at 14 and 16? Was there an allowance? Tell us a little bit about what money was like in your household, your upbringing, your environment.
I always had this weird feeling. I never asked. I always felt like maybe I was a burden to my family. I was only child and I just didn't want to ever ask for money at all. I didn't want to ask for clothes. I didn't want to do any of that. So I just said I'll work so then I can take care of everything myself, my own shoes, my own shirts. I pick out my own stuff. I worked at the mall, so I would be able to go do my own shopping, get my own food. I just wanted to be as independent as possible.
From a very early age. That's pretty dope.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
And so what were you thinking then at 14 when you got your first paycheck? You went from depending on your family to I want to be independent, but still wasn't a whole bunch of money. So how were you figuring out what to do with the funds that you were earning at that early age?
I didn't figure out anything. I didn't know anything. So I was just getting what I wanted whenever I wanted it, which back then was just being able to go to the movies when I wanted to, buying clothes when I wanted to, basically becoming what the country kind of teaches you to be, basically a consumer. So as soon as I had money, I'm throwing it back. I used to be heavy into hip hop. So I'm collecting CDs. Every new CD that came out, I'm getting 3 or 4 CDs. I was just spending. And it wasn't a whole bunch. I enjoyed my teenage years, but looking back, I'm like, man, I could have played a different game back then, which I'm glad I'm still young enough to realize that there is a game to play and I can chart my course a different way.
Yeah, for sure. I think that that's a pretty standard thing at a young age. If you don't know what to do with the money, you just have a good time with it. If your basic needs are met, then everything above and beyond that is let's have a good time. So,
yeah. A crazy part of that is when I was 17, 18, somebody told me, you need to read this book called Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And I said, oh, okay. And I never read it. And then I went to college, never read it. Then I got out of college, was about to get married. Then I read it. And I was like, man, if I had read this when they first told me about it, it would have been a game changer. I didn't even know what it was about. I just knew somebody had recommended it. Once I read that book, light bulbs went off.
Everybody says that about Rich Dad, Poor Dad. If you haven't checked the book out, you should check it out because it definitely is a game changer for many. And just the way that you said you can think about and position yourself around money. So,
yeah, I agree.
So, okay, let's talk about your college experience a little bit.
Sure.
Where did you decide to go to school? How did you go about that? Was there a conversation in your household about how college was going to be paid for or?
Yeah. Oh, man. That's a deep combo. I honestly was not going to go to college. I was very entrepreneurial. And I thought back then I could just go and start a business or something. I didn't know what it was going to be yet. But I knew I wanted to do something on my own. I didn't want to go the whole college route. But back then, technology wasn't where it is now. And really, in my mind, I couldn't see any other option. So my parents were just really heavy on me going to college. My mom was talking about how she was going to take out loans and things to go. I only applied to one school, which is right here, South Carolina State University. I got in, and that's the school I went to, and I made the most out of it. When I was in high school, I was more of a C student, not based off of intellect, but just based off of not really caring.
Mm-hmm.
But once I got to college, I was more of like a B+, A student, because I actually cared because I knew my mom was going to have to pay for this. And I wanted to take it very seriously. So I studied marketing and business. I just figured, well, let me sit here for these next few years and try to figure this game out of business. So then when I do go start this business, that this dream of mine, I didn't know what it was at the time, but at least I'll be prepared.
Yeah, I think that's pretty cool, too. Like, okay, I got this entrepreneurial spirit, but if I'm going to have to go to school, let me make sure I'm learning everything I can so that I can apply that to the thing that I'm most passionate about, which is being an entrepreneur.
Exactly.
And so then your mom ended up paying for the college and the loans and et cetera. Like, you got out of school and you didn't have to really worry about that too much?
No, but then I went to grad school and that was on me.
Ah, then what had happened was...
I went to grad school, which was at Sherry University. And I focused my MBA in acquisitions. And I had no idea why I chose that. I initially was going to choose information technology as my focus, but something said choose acquisitions. And when I started opening up those textbooks and reading about what acquisitions was, I said, I think I've stumbled onto something here that very few people will know anything about. And I'm going to run with this. So maybe it was a blessing in disguise going this route that I never wanted to go. Because now I have access to information that I've always wanted to know.
Yeah, I think you bring up an interesting point about how many different majors exist out there, how many different opportunities, roles, job descriptions. There's so many different things. And sometimes we kind of get bogged down in the, are you a lawyer, doctor, engineer, teacher? There's this kind of cookie cutter set of things that kind of come to mind when you think of jobs, but there's hundreds of thousands of different job titles out there, hundreds of thousands of different ways to go about doing something, and hundreds of thousands of ways of getting education in order to be well equipped to be able to handle whatever it is that you want to go after in life. So I think you're really, like you said, very fortunate to have found out, here's this thing called acquisitions. I didn't know that was even something you could major in or get a master's degree in. And now here's a whole new world of small group of people are only going after this area. And now you have a specialty and expertise within your community that not very many other people have.
And to jump on that, specialization is really key. I mean, I'm not sure if anyone else has given that jewel, but if you do not specialize in something, it's going to be hard to separate you. Even if you're a lawyer, like right now, for a project I'm working on in the film industry, I'm trying to connect with IP lawyers. And the only way I'll know that is if you market yourself as an IP lawyer. If you just market yourself as a lawyer, I will never know what you specialize in. So what I've also been doing on my end is making sure that when I'm dealing with people, dealing with business owners, I specialize in a specific area. And that just opens up the floodgates to just work in that one arena. And it brings more clientele in by doing it that way.
That brings up another really good point. So we say in the network that I belong to, it's all about the niche or niche, depending on who says it, how you want to say it, if you want to be fancy or not.
Right.
But yeah, that niche marketing is a key factor in really, like you said, being able to drill down, be an expert in your area, but also in being able to get clients. Sometimes we think we should cast the broadest net and say, oh, I serve everybody. I'm this. Like you said, if I'm just a lawyer, then I do all kinds of law. But by really being able to say I'm an expert in this, one, you can become an expert in that.
Yep.
But also people know, call so-and-so if you're looking for this particular thing. And it actually helps you a lot with business once you get the network out there and get the word out about what it is that you do. So yeah, I think that's a really cool point.
Thank you.
So you're in college, or you're in grad school now. Are you working while you're going to grad school? You said you had to take out some loans this time around. So how are things working from a money perspective at this point?
I did take out loans. And what I did was I did not work during grad school. I wanted to finish up very quickly. So I just focused on finishing and then connecting and networking. So actually, during this time, no money's coming in.
So did you move back home with your parents? How are you?
Yes. So I'm back at home with my parents. I'm getting my graduate degree. And everything I feared is what I'm living, which is being underneath my parents' house, not really having any money, and kind of feeling stuck. But then in the back of your mind, you kind of know that you have this secret formula to success. So you're like, it's not too bad, but everybody you shake hands with, everybody you talk to, you just feel less than who you are because you haven't accomplished anything. You haven't done anything and you're still in this limbo. So that was actually the best experience. Sometimes the best time of your life is not having anything and just being creative and accepting who you are. My entire life before that, I always had money to do something with. I always had a fresh paycheck coming in where I could go and just buy things and make myself feel better. And this part of my life, I had to realize I had to feel better without the money. And if I didn't have that experience, I would have never been able to get to where I am today. I had to be happy with just being myself and not having money and all this other stuff coming in.
I think you just dropped a pretty cool nugget on us. I always say my net worth and my self-worth are not related.
Yeah.
And it sounds like you kind of were thinking along those lines initially, like, oh, well, I don't have money. These people must think less of me. And I'm so broke right now. The struggle is real. But then you realize my net worth and my self-worth are not related. I'm a great person. I can be happy. There's a lot of things you can do in life that are free. And it's not really tied to what my earnings are. Yes, I want to be a good earner, but whether I'm earning or not earning, that's not tied to who I am on the inside.
Exactly. And I feel very confident that if I move to any city, if you give me a small window, I can build a network now because I know my self-worth. It took that time to learn that.
Yeah, I think that's pretty cool. Okay, so you get out of college, got some student loan debt. How do you figure out what the next steps are? How do you get from being under your parents' roof? How do you start organizing yourself so that you can get back to independence?
You humble yourself and realize that you're going to need cash flow. And so I started working at a major bank, Wells Fargo. at the phone bank. So if you lost your debit card back then, you would call me up and say, I lost my debit card. Please put a hold on it and send me another one. I was that guy you called at the phone bank. So I did that from 5 a.m. to 2 p.m. while I worked on my dream throughout the rest of the day. And back then, trying to acquire companies or trying to be in a mix of media and entertainment, I was dealing with media and entertainment type of companies, dealing with people from that area, which was at the time Columbia, and people with technology now coming in. See, now the key to the entire story here is as I'm progressing mentally, technology is progressing exponentially to where now the ideas I have can actually be used. If I never had technology, I don't know what I would have done.
So technology was key in you being able to change the game and really be able to start to write your own story.
Well, yeah, because if I'm only around the same people all the time, a lot of the people that I may have been around at the time weren't dreaming.
Right.
They were good with where they were. And at the time, so was I. But I needed to start connecting with people who were the creators, the thinkers, the movers and shakers of society. And so that's what I started doing. I started wanting to talk to everybody who had the craziest dreams, the craziest ideas. I like to be best friends with people who are into startups or venture capital. I don't specifically deal with venture capital. I like dealing with seasoned companies, but I like people who are fresh thinking and starting new waves, starting new trends. To me, that's more fun than being around people who are not dreamers and who are okay with the daily grind. I can't go that route anymore. I've been there before and I don't want to go back.
Gotcha. So what did you do then in this time period that kind of led to what you're doing today? Did you pick up some odd jobs or did you go straight into starting your own company? Tell us a little bit about, yeah, where did you work then to what you're doing now?
Sure. I immediately, once I had my MBA, I started my own company. That didn't mean I made money, but I immediately started it and had it up and running. Then I just started reaching out to everybody I possibly could to learn the game of acquisitions. And that's where I found some investors out in California. I found some people out in Georgia to connect with. And just to be able to be part of certain deals allows you to see how it goes from start to finish. So that was my goal, is let me just be a part of it. You don't have to give me credit or anything like that. I just want to see it from beginning to end. So I found private investors through technology, reaching out to people, talking with them, developing a relationship. That's key, y'all. Relationship. I'm not really big on having a whole bunch of people around me, but I am key on having those 10 people around me that are serious about life and serious about going places. So I started finding my small little tribe. And once I found that, as I'm doing my corporate job, I can slowly position myself out a few years later. I only worked at Wells Fargo for about 2 or 3 years. I started off in Columbia. I got promoted to a job in Charlotte, North Carolina. So I moved to Charlotte. I knew that's where I wanted to go anyway to have my business, and slowly transitioned out.
Gotcha. So the entrepreneurial effort started out as a side hustle initially because you're still working, but it's kind of like an unofficial intern is what you were doing. You found the right people to connect with and said, teach me what you know, because I want to be good at this like you.
I'll be honest with you, Lauren. I'm still an unofficial intern.
Right.
So my entire life, if I was really into podcasting, I would call you up and say, hey, let me sit on all your calls. I won't say a word. Let me just sit on all your podcast calls. Let me sit on everything that you're doing so I can be a sponge and learn it. That's just the way I've always been. I'm always going to be an intern. My main goal is to be at the next level, even if it means I have to be at the bottom of that next level. So no matter what I do, I'm going to be positioning myself to be an intern. And then as I move up, I'm like, okay, it's time to be an intern again. I got to go learn this new world. Just like the last few months, I got into film. I've never been into film before. So it's all new to me to kind of come from an executive producer perspective and look at things from a total different world, because film is a different animal. But I love it. I'm an intern again. So it's learning. And then when I do 4 or 5 films, then maybe I'll go learn something else. Maybe I want to learn aerospace and learn about NASA or Elon Musk and go sit with them. I don't know, wherever life takes me.
Yes, I love it. I love it. I love it. Always be an intern.
always be an intern. Don't steal that. I might make that my book title. Don't take it.
That is our little tagline.
Okay,
together,
we can do right? that. I like that.
Let's share that tagline. Always be an intern, though. No, that's really dope because it drives home the point that you never stop educating yourself. No matter what it is that you get good at, there's always something else that you could be getting good at or something that you could be better at.
Another way to put it is always be dumb. And so what I mean by that is always pick up a new book and approach it as if you know nothing, because you really don't. Everything you think you know, you really don't know. You only know what you think you thought you knew. And then things change. Things are always constantly changing. There was no way 5 or 6 years ago you and I would be getting on a thing called Zoom or getting on anything where we would be able to have this connection. You're in one place, I'm in another. But because of technology and because we're open enough to embrace a new dimension of where we are in life, we're able to have these conversations openly and honestly. And so you always have to be trying to get more information. I order new books every month from Amazon, just trying to learn.
Yeah. It's really important that we be thinking about, like you said, the idea that education is something that requires the investment of time. That whether or not you have to invest money, you have to invest time to get educated. And so no matter what part of life you reach or what area of wealth or success or all these different things, there's always this investment of time that's going to be necessary for you to continue to learn so you can continue to be great.
I agree.
So I think that's the point that you just hit on here is we're talking about money here on this podcast, but at the same time, we're talking about investing, and investing comes in many different forms and fashions. And the investment of time is what ultimately leads to you being able to have the money that you want.
I believe, based off what you said, I think time and knowledge, or time in the right knowledge, is way more valuable than having some huge capital amount. Because you can have $1 million of capital, but if you don't have the knowledge, it's just going to go back into somebody else's pocket because you're going to throw it out into the world the wrong way and never see it again. But if you took the time to get the knowledge, which is what I always practice, there's a scripture, I can't think of it, where it says a wise man always has wisdom coming right at his doorstep. If you are searching for wisdom, it will just start showing up in your world. And so that's what I try to attract. I want wisdom. All that money stuff and all the other stuff is cool, but if you give me wisdom, then I can last forever. I can live beyond my physical being if I have wisdom. But if I don't have wisdom, I just have money, then I only live for that one lifetime. I want to live forever.
Yeah, I think it's a good way of looking at it. All right, so let's change gears a little bit and talk about what you're doing now. So you're in acquisitions. Tell us a little bit about what that means, what you do, how someone gets into that. What does that process look like? Tell us about that.
Sure. Basically, I would consider myself a private investor. Most people would consider it a private equity investor. And so one way of approaching private equity is to find businesses who are looking to sell their business and finding ways to finance the purchase of that business so then you can acquire. So why do this? Why even go this route? My stats may be a little off here, and I do apologize in advance. But it's something like 80% of businesses fail within the first 5 years, and like 95% of businesses fail within the first 10 years. And my numbers could be off a little bit, but it's something like that. And so the reason why I am in the private equity side and I'm trying to acquire seasoned companies, usually 10 years or older, is by the time I'm acquiring these companies, they've already proven themselves over the first 10 years to be a proven company. And so instead of trying to start a company and raise it up for the next 10 years, which is the odds are telling you, it's not going to work. Now, some people will, some people won't be successful, but the odds are telling you, that may not work too well for you. Why not acquire a company that's already beaten the odds, have it in your portfolio, and instantly have cash flow coming to you? And so that was what some of my mentors shared with me over my interning time, which is still going on. I'm still learning every day. But during my intern time, it's, why do you want to start a business when you can just acquire one? I was thinking to myself, well, I don't have the necessary capital to acquire one, so I might as well just start one. But little did I know, it doesn't necessarily take capital. It takes knowledge. And so what I've been focusing on now is using the specialized knowledge of acquisitions to start purchasing media companies and entertainment companies. And we're really excited of entering into that space because it's already landed us one project in the film industry, which I'm coming on board a potential executive producer over a feature film. The paperwork's not done yet, but hopefully we'll be able to finish that up. And it's brought in a whole new avenue for me to go towards. And I'm really excited about it.
So you talked about this idea of not necessarily needing capital in order to acquire someone's company. What does that look like then? If you don't need capital, what do you need? You need somebody else's money.
Yeah. I mean, you can use someone else's money, or maybe the company that you're going to acquire has a lot of debt. You can basically use the debt as a way of financing the business. So by the time you acquire it, you don't have any debt. There's 10 or 11 different strategies that you could use to try to acquire a company. Now, it's not easy. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you just be able to knock on someone's door. I want to acquire your business. DJ Moultrie told me to acquire and I can acquire it. It does take work and it does take specialization. And it does take having someone in your corner who knows this stuff. But it doesn't necessarily mean it has to take capital, is all I'm saying. Now, most times people do use some form of capital, some type of financing, but it doesn't have to. And I think that's the key, is I've seen people who have acquired businesses for like less than $100 when it's all said and done. I've seen people who actually, after acquiring a business, got paid from acquiring the business from someone else. And so I know that sounds crazy, but that's the world in private equity. That's how it can work if you know what you're doing. And you have to get with the right people to know what you're doing.
I like it. I like it. So tell us a little bit about then the first time you did one of these deals, what that looked like when you got the first paycheck. Were you just through the moon? Was it a fat check where you're like, "Ooh, I made it. I'm officially a business," or was it kind of, okay, let me just turn this money back and put it to the, what were you thinking when you got your first acquisition, I guess?
I was thinking, wow, is this simple? And because my entire life, I was a slave. My entire life, the way I approached things, I was operating from a slave mentality. Please hire me. Please take me in. Please pay me $6 an hour. Please pay me $7 an hour. Please, I'll be your best worker. I'll do the best. Here's my resume. Please hire me. Put the outfit on, sit down, interview for a job. Everything I was doing was from a place of please and of beg and of need. And I think once I flipped it and then it came to me, I started realizing, oh, never come from a point of desperation again, ever in your life. Never put yourself in a position to be asking or begging someone for your well-being. That's too much power for people to have over you. And that's what I was really thinking. It wasn't necessarily the money or anything that made me free. It was my mentality. I was like, oh, I'm free now. The money wasn't the freedom. It was, oh, these jokers really was trying to play me all this time. There's people out there that will never tell you. They'll know this information, that you can go out and build passive income. You can build these great things in your life, but they'll never tell it to you. Because if they tell it to you, then you're no longer in their system for them to manipulate and control. And so once I was on the other side of the game, because as soon as you acquire the company, you're either the chairman, you're the CEO, and now you've got whatever the amount of the staff is, all those people's destinies are in your hand. I used to be that person where I'm just sitting at the desk hoping that when the big dogs from corporate, from New York come down, oh, please don't spot me out and fire me. Mm-hmm. What kind of life is that? And so the mind shift of, oh no, I'm never letting anyone speak to me like that again. I'm not going down that road anymore. I'm going to build my own thing and never have to rely on anyone else for my well-being. And that was a very powerful moment.
Yeah, I can imagine that would be a super powerful moment. The mind shift is something that people frequently talk about on the show, is I was living this way and then I changed my mindset and then that was able to change the game for me. But even in changing the mindset, you also have to change some of your actions. And so, I mean, we haven't talked a lot about like how you're organizing your finances or how you were organizing your finances during this time to kind of get yourself on your feet. And what did it mean to be living below your means, or what strategies were you using to organize your finances so that you could also feel free in addition to changing your mindset?
I basically started reading everything. Tony Robbins, Money, Master the Game, or Master the Game of Money. I started reading a lot and I started seeing, okay, well, I have this money coming in. What should I do with it? And then, the world opened up, because now when you have free flowing cash flow coming through outside of your expenses being taken out, you can really live the life you want to. Then it takes you into some debates. Do you buy the house? Do you rent the house? Do you buy a vacation spot, or do you just Airbnb it for a month? And then if it's a business expense, how much of that can be written off? I'm going to tell you another thing. Seek wise counsel. The biggest thing for me was speaking with someone like you who has wise counsel. Before I make any decisions, I talk to two or three people. My wife is a CPA, so that's another big plus for me, is having someone who already understands finances and having that conversation from the very beginning. The very foundation of my day is spent with my wife. She's a CPA. Having an attorney, having people who have already kind of been down this road where you can call and reach out to them. I think those are my biggest things. Having advisors, having wise counsel has been key for me. And then I think it was Secrets of the Millionaire Mind, where they talked about having different accounts for different purposes, so then they never get mixed up. I try to take everybody's information, and then I say, okay, well, now I get to do my own blueprint. So having different accounts, one's a play account. This account is where I play. And so I define what play is. Mm-hmm. And so for me, that's like vacations. And this account is strictly a capital growing account. This account will be moved towards other investments. And so you have four or five different accounts that play their own different game. And you let money take care of, not necessarily take care of itself. You put it in positions where it starts working for you and you don't have to actually go chase it anymore. And that is very freeing.
Yeah, I like to call it the bucket system. I'm sure some financial guru is the originator or whatever you want to call it, but pretty much similar to what you were describing, where you put your fixed expenses, whatever you know, your reoccurring bills on a monthly basis in one account. Mm-hmm. Well, I always say pay yourself first. So you put your savings in one account.
Yes. Yes.
Whether that's retirement or a savings account or an investment account or whatever, this is the money that you're setting aside for yourself because you are worth it. Then secondly, you put the fixed expenses, which is like what's going to keep a roof over your head and lights on, et cetera, et cetera. Any of those reoccurring bills. And then, like you said, that third bucket is the variable expenses. And it's like, yeah, what you were calling the play account.
Yes.
And it's like, yeah, go ahead, have a good time. This is what's left over because you've already taken care of business. You know, you saved up some, you know, you've paid your bills, and this is what's left for you to do. But when you spent all of it, you're done until you can get more money into that account, sort of thing. You're not pulling from any of these other accounts.
And another strategy I try to stay with, I'm getting better at it, is you don't purchase any liabilities until you've acquired a new asset to purchase that liability. That way you never are topsy-turvy. So if I want to go buy this BMW, I don't know how much that costs, but let's just say $100,000. If I wanted to buy a BMW, I would need to get an acquisition of some sort that brought in, for me, this is the way I operate, brings in $100,000 to purchase whatever this thing is. Instead of just saying, well, I have $100,000, let me just go buy it. And so then now my liability just goes right out the door and I don't have anything to replace it. So the way I think is, once I acquire this business, I can get this car. Or once I flip this money wherever, maybe it's in the stock market or something, I don't know, however somebody wants to play their game. Let me put this money here. And when it comes back to me the way I would like for it to, when it reaches a certain amount, now I can go do this. And so that's the way I kind of do it. Really, you should be watching your money so much that you really don't got time to look at nobody else, because you playing your own game. You really shouldn't have any time to be worried about what's going on out there. You should be playing your game so well that no one can touch your game.
Right. Yeah, I like that. You know, not thinking about the whole keeping up with the Joneses is what the cliche says. you're really focused on your lane, you don't have time to really compare yourself to others or worry about what others are doing, because you've got clear goals and you're going passionately after your goals. So
exactly.
Yeah, let's switch gears a little bit and talk about family a little bit. You said you have your wife. Do you have any children?
I do not have any children. Not yet.
Just you and Bay, right?
That's correct.
So what is that like in the household? You said you got a CPA wife. When you guys first got married, what did it look like trying to marry the finances and having financial discussions? What was that whole process, or what is that process in you being an individual, she being an individual, and then you guys coming together and really organizing finances in the midst of that?
All the conversations have to happen before the marriage, at least in my advice, is marriage is love and all that great stuff, but also it's a business partnership.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to make sure that the person that you're partnering with is going in the same direction as you. And so I spent a lot of time in the dating time having those conversations, not from the very beginning, but more towards the end prior to asking her to marry me, was having conversations about the very topic and making sure that we're on the same page. And I believe that you should have your joint stuff, but then I believe everybody should be their own selves too, so you don't lose yourself. If everything's so joint and you don't have anything by yourself, you'll forget who you are and what your hopes and dreams are before you even met this person. So I believe in having your individual accounts that you do, but then also having something combined that you two are working towards together as well.
I think that's a good strategy for those who are looking for something to say, is it possible to marry the finances?
Oh, yeah.
You can definitely marry part of them and keep some for yourself, or marry all of them. But it's whatever the strategy is that's going to best work for that household. But definitely that you guys need to be open and transparent about what's going on. Yeah.
That's what's about. It's about the transparency. You can do anything you want to do in life. It's all about the execution. And if you have the right people on the team to do that. If you don't have a whole bunch of three-point shooters, you probably shouldn't be shooting threes. So you have to know who you're dealing with and who's on your team. And before you start making decisions, make sure it caters everybody's strength.
For sure, for sure. So how often do you guys have the money discussion? Is it one person is mostly in charge of the monthly bills or all that? Or how does that take place on a day-to-day basis or reoccurring basis?
We basically weave it into everything that we do, because everything is a money decision. Mm. I mean, I don't know what isn't a money decision. You know, hey, let's go see our nephew. We got to fly out there, right? So now we got to fly out there. That's a money decision. Let's go to the movies. Money decision. Really, even if you're not married, everything is a money decision. Even if you're just interning somewhere to learn information, you got to know your money. And what I don't understand about a lot of people is y'all are playing money games and don't even understand your money. And so I think I truly believe before we try to learn a second language, Spanish, French, whatever, the second language everybody should learn is money.
I like it. I like it.
All the other stuff in high school and college, all the other stuff that we learned, it was cool. But if you don't understand money, you can't really have a conversation with anyone. And let me tell you, the number one people I do not trust. I do not trust people who say you should never talk about money. I don't trust people that don't want to talk about money. Because if you don't want to talk about money, then how you going to get it?
Go on, preach, preacher.
And so I've literally sat down at lunches with people and I start talking about money. They'll look underneath their glasses. You know, they're all professional and everything. They'll sip their little coffee and say, I don't discuss money. And I'll be ready to go. Because if you don't discuss money, how am I going to do a deal with you?
Right.
If I want to acquire a business, or if I want to acquire this, or if I want to work with you, or I think you're great for this project and they're paying 2% equity, 2% equity is a money talk. So now I can't even offer you a 2% equity. And so it's just, I know that they're not thinking that deep about it. They're just programmed to say, well, we don't discuss money over here.
Okay.
Well, then I don't need to be over here. I want to sit down with people I can talk money with all day and they're not being issued.
Openness, that honesty, and that willingness to, you say, kind of put the cards on the table. And even if it's, you know, a negotiation, you know what you're willing to do or not do, it's still a money conversation. And so not being willing to have the conversation in any aspect, whether you're talking with your spouse, your boo, your siblings, your parents, as soon as the conversation gets shut down and someone doesn't want to go there, it hinders the ability to, like you said, to be successful. everybody's ability to be successful. Yeah, so I think that's a really good point.
I agree.
All right, so let's get to the final wrap up here. We're doing what I like to call the final sprint, where I'm going to ask you a few questions, kind of rapid fire. You give me your best answers and we'll wrap it on up.
Okay, I'll try my best.
All right, first thing, something you do for fun that doesn't cost anything.
It kind of costs. I love to read, but I mean, I have to buy the book.
Well, you can go to the library.
Yeah, but then you got to pay for, well, the library card is free. Anyway, reading a book. Reading a book is probably my favorite thing to do that technically doesn't cost any money to do.
Gotcha. Okay. Most meaningful gift you've ever received. Who was it from and why was it meaningful?
The most meaningful gift I ever had was a handshake. Mm. It was from Magic Johnson. I was like 7 or 8 years old. I was living in Hawaii. And I think he had just came out with his book. That was after he was diagnosed with HIV. And he had a book and he was talking about overcoming challenges. And my mom took me up to the mall. I think it was Pearl Ridge Mall in Hawaii. And I stood in line for like an hour and he gave me a handshake. And then he signed my book too. I bought the book. Well, my mom probably bought the book at the time. And he signed my book for me and I still have it to this day.
Wow.
But the handshake is what was most important to me, for him to respect me as a man at 7 years old. He whispered something in my ear. I don't remember what it was, but I know it, for whatever reason, changed my life because he just took time to really talk to me. It was, you know, it was only 2 minutes, but I appreciated that.
Yeah. We take for granted how a short period of time can really be impactful for someone else. So
yeah.
Worst advice you've ever received?
That same person I was talking about earlier, he told me never talk about money in front of people. And that was the stupidest thing I ever heard in my life. I just still to this day don't get it. And ever since then, I've been talking about money with everyone. And it's been life changing.
Yeah. Best advice you've ever received then?
Never lose your imagination. I forget who told me that. But I remember someone said, whatever you do, do not lose your imagination. That's your key to your success, is to be able to think beyond where you currently are to create your own world.
Yeah, I like it. I like it. Got to keep your imagination. Creativity is everything.
That's right.
All right. So our final question is, can you share with us one thing that you would like to improve about your finances in the upcoming year?
Two different things. I would like to work with more people who want me to acquire their business. I always want to do that. But I'm also looking into advising startups. I don't want to acquire startups, but I do want to advise startups. That's really been a key thing for me. I want to start giving back to maybe the early 20-somethings. I mean, you don't have to be 20, but maybe the early 20-somethings who have a dream. And most people that they bump into are telling them that their dream sucks and it will never happen. I've been there. And so I just kind of want to be able to swoop in and be like, oh, it can happen. Trust me. I've seen this. I grew up in a church in Columbia where they had their own credit. And so I remember I told a church in local area that, you know, you guys can have a credit union. And they looked at me like I was crazy. They said, you could never have a credit union. And I know it's true because I literally, an hour down the road, is a church that has its own credit union.
Right.
And so I like to be the person who can walk into a room and say, oh, trust me, it could be done. Because I've seen it. I've seen all it. I mean, we put people in space. We can do whatever we want to do. I just hate when people tell you you can't do something. It's stupid.
Right. So what's the action item for you to be able to do that, to reach that goal?
Well, I'm working with a company by the name of Exec Ranks, and they match you what with up and coming startups. I have an upcoming interview with an entertainment company, so we'll see if it's a good mesh. But also just talking through social media. I talk to a lot of people through social media that reach out to me. There's several different networking apps where I'm talking to people. I actually talked to a guy today who has a crazy good idea in the food space, and he's a startup. And it sounds like he's interested in me coming on as an advisor. So I look forward to seeing where that goes.
That's dope. All right, just finish us out with what you're up to now, how we can support you, where we can find you.
Sure.
It's your time to stand on the podium and shine.
Sure. You can go to my Twitter and it's OBA DJM, OBA DJM, the same for Instagram. If you'd like to connect with me, if you're a business owner, you can go to klgacquisitions.com and you can read about our company. And my email address will be there. It's djm@klgacquisitions.com. And I just look forward to working with people who are really trying to go and do things. I am working on a book that I hope to have out by the end of this year. I don't know if it will be called Always Be an Intern or not. I'm still deciding.
You got to buy the rights for me, though. Like.
that is true. But I do want to get the story out of being that 14-year-old kid thinking that the way to success is working hard. I think it's a myth. Actually, I know it's a myth. And so if I could go back and tell them anything, I'd tell them to do the same thing, that 14-year-old kid. I would still play it out the same way, but I would still whisper in his ear and say, man, you're getting great training for when you start owning your own things, that you'll be able to look back on all this and realize that everybody was trying to play you. Everybody is lying to you, and they're just giving you chump change because the real money's somewhere else.
All right, DJ. Well, thanks so much for being on the show today. Really appreciate your time, all the little nuggets of wisdom you dropped on us. And look forward to following you and seeing what's going on in the future.
Well, thank you. And I look forward to seeing your podcast grow, continued much success, and maybe in the future we can have a part two.
Hey, part two.
I hope you enjoyed listening to DJ's Money Memoir. We discussed the importance of finding your niche. That means, what do you specialize in? I think it's very valuable, not for just those in acquisitions, but anyone in business, to choose an area that allows you to focus so that you can become an expert in that area, and then you can set yourself apart from the competition. Our word of the day, acquisitions. An acquisition is when one company buys more than 50% of another company's shares in order to assume control. This allows the acquiring company to make decisions regarding the newly acquired assets without the approval of the target company's shareholders. So once you become the main owner, then you also become the main decision maker. That's what acquisitions are all about. I know when I think of acquisitions, I think large corporation with lots of monies taking over a small corporation and firing all their employees, etc. But DJ shared with us that whether you're large or small, there are dozens of different ways to acquire companies, and some of them don't even require capital. I think it's important, though, to first educate yourself before embarking on any new endeavor. Thank you for tuning in today. We hope you found this episode worth listening to. And of course, if you have financial questions, suggestions for guests, or would like to share your own money memoir, please contact us via our website, worth-listening.com.